Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today at Science Gallery Bengaluru's Contagion and our very first Meet the Team event. It's a pleasure to have you all here today, and we are hoping that this would be an interactive and engaging session where you can meet the team who have been largely responsible for putting up the exhibition. And please use this as an opportunity to ask any questions that you might have about their experience doing so and the challenges they faced, their learnings from this journey towards Contagion, but also any questions you might have about how digital exhibitions are put together, what it takes to bring something together of this scale, especially during the pandemic. So I'd like to start by introducing our director, Dr. Janhvi Phalke. At the start, we're going to have a short introduction to Science Gallery Bengaluru, but before that, a little bit about her. Janhvi is the founding director of Science Gallery Bengaluru and the Sir Ashutosh Mukherjee visiting professor, or formerly at the National Institute of Advanced Studies. She was at King's College London and was a fellow at the Institute of Advanced Study in Berlin. She was also the external curator to the Science Museum in London and has been a scholar in residence at the Deutsches Museum Munich. She is a writer. Her book, Atomic State, Big Science in 20th Century India, is definitely a must read. And her film, Cyclotron, is another must watch. So she read civics and politics at the University of Bombay and the School of Oriental and African Studies, London. And she holds a doctoral degree in the history of science and technology from the Georgia Institute of Technology, Atlanta. She is known fondly by all of us as JP, and she runs many, many meetings every day. So I'll now hand over to Janhvi to give you a short introduction to Science Gallery before we get into meeting the rest of the team.
Thank you, Madhu, for that kind introduction. In modern Indian history, JP was also Jayaprakash Narayan. So there might be something to explore there, but I'll leave that for our next meeting. So welcome, everyone. It's a pleasure to be amongst family and friends. I see that some of you are here who worked with us before. So it's great to have you all here. And a few words about Science Gallery Bengaluru before we begin talking about what we've been up to in the last year and what it took for all of us collectively to bring to you Contagion. So for those of you who are joining us for the first time and are not familiar with Science Gallery, we are a part of an international network of galleries with two galleries in the United States, five in Europe, one in Australia. At the moment, Science Gallery Bengaluru is the only Asian gallery, but I'm hopeful that that will change in the future. We are likely going to be the only Indian gallery in the foreseeable future. So in that sense, the scope of our work is national. Our sibling galleries are all located on university campuses. So it all started out in Trinity College Dublin and then spread across the globe, as you can see. Bangalore is a slight outlier in that, for those of you who are aware, our higher education is conducted in silos and our universities rarely have large budgets for public engagement, as a result of which the government of Karnataka stepped in and have basically founded Science Gallery Bengaluru. That said, we do work very closely with three academic partners, with the Indian Institute of Science as our lead academic partner and the National Center for Biological Sciences and Srishti as our collaborating partners. What is Science Gallery Bengaluru about? What is it for? We look at ourselves as committed to bridging the distance between research and the public. We look at ourselves as understanding, like our colleagues in Europe do, science as inclusive of the human and the natural sciences, and culture as a large encompassing idea for all forms of artistic expression. The method with which we work is that of experiment. So this is more or less how we will be realized. Our building is under construction. So while we share what is in the center with all our eight sibling galleries, which is the public engagement complex, what is new to us and what is pioneering for Bangalore is the public lab complex. So this is basically going to inform the way we work when we go forward. This is how our building looks right now, fairly desolate given the pandemic, but hopefully by the end of next year, we'll be able to welcome you as we open our doors. We have been programming now since October 2019. We were able to conduct two of our exhibitions physically. The first Elements, which was to mark 150 years of Mendeleev's periodic table, was at the Rangoli Metro Arts Center in Bangalore at MG Road Metro Station. Submerge, which was our exhibition on water, was held at the Bangalore International Center. And we partnered with the Smithsonian Institution, among many other local institutions, for that exhibition. And Phytopia and Contagion are our online efforts. Phytopia was our first online exhibition in August last year about everything plants, for which we partnered with the John Innes Center in Norwich and the Natural History Museum, again, among many other partners. And Contagion, which is what hopefully we'll discuss in detail today, is our sort of first fully online, full 45-day long exhibition season, for which we have, again, many partners, the Robert Koch Institute and Jenner's House, which is the Edward Jenner Museum, being a couple of them. Through our programming so far, which is through our four exhibitions, basically, but also some other activities, we have very strong partnerships with Bangalore-based institutions, so some of whom are showcased here on the slide. Beyond Bengaluru, also we have partners who we work quite closely with. So the Public Lecture Series this time, for example, is sponsored by the Indian National Science Academy, and the masterclasses and workshops are in partnership with and sponsored by the TBT Welcome India Alliance. We've worked with the United States consulate in Chennai over two exhibitions now. So, you know, we work with them as well very closely. This is sort of a full spectrum of partners we have for Contagion. I've mentioned pretty much all of them other than the Chennai Photo Biennale. And my colleagues will discuss that with, you know, as we move further. This is more or less what the building will look like when we are ready and done and, you know, standing there to welcome you. Thanks for your attention, and that was that. Thank you,
ma'am. Just to let everyone know, we're happy to take questions about Science Gallery. Janvi can, you know, wax far more eloquently about any particular aspect of it towards the end of the session. So, or if you have any that you would like to drop in the chat box right now about what we're doing, things that we're going to be doing in the future, do put them in the chat box, right? And any of the members of our team here today will answer you. So I'd like to now quickly introduce you to the team over here. As you know, Science Gallery is all about interdisciplinarity and working across disciplines. That's very true for our team as well. Everyone is from a very diverse disciplinary background and has been doing a lot of interesting things before getting to the gallery. So I'll, without further ado, I will start by introducing Gayatri. Gayatri is our program associate, but she is also a writer and researcher with work experience in the field of reporting, publishing, and digital media. Recently, she completed her master's in creative writing and literary arts from the Ambedkar University, Delhi, where she focused on literary devices and narrative techniques employed in speculative fiction. Apart from fiction, Gayatri enjoys writing about gender, culture, and other subjects as well. Her work has appeared in First Post, The Better India, The Lady's Finger, and Yahoo. The next person I'd like to introduce is Komal Jain. Komal is our design associate, and she focuses primarily on the spatial design of the SGP complex. For this exhibition, she has been heavily involved in the design of the exhibition website. She is freshly graduated with a bachelor's in exhibition design from the National Institute of Design, Ahmedabad. Her work revolves around museums, game strategies, and its applications, as well as the use of digital media to create memorable learning experiences. Earlier this year, her graduation project was presented at the Designing for Children with a Focus on Play and Learn conference organized by IDC at the Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay. I'd also now like to introduce you to the lone wolf in our team, Sankalp Singh. He is our video editor and responsible for the amazing series of videos called COVIDs that's been put out during Contagion. Sankalp is originally an electronics and communications engineer and now is an audio-visual communication designer. He completed his bachelor's in technology from IIIMET Jaipur in 2013, after which he did his postgraduate diploma in commercial visual communication and photography from Light and Life Ooty. Sankalp is hopefully going to complete his postgraduate from the National Institute of Design, Gandhinagar in 2021. Hill's work paradoxically centers around contemporary commercial visual practices and late stage capitalism. I'm sure that's going to have a lot of interesting questions. The next person I'd like to introduce is Shweta Jangi. She is our Science Gallery Bengaluru's design associate. She's a graphic designer and a documentary photographer. She graduated from Symbiosis International University in 2015 in audio visual production and directed a few short films before working with acclaimed filmmaker Anand Gandhi at his production house in Mumbai. She's interested in the fusion of social concerns, art, and communication. Perfect for Science Gallery. Examining how to use visual media for social change and exploring critical theory around society and identity. In 2020, her work was exhibited at the Fotofesto Schiedam in Rotterdam, Netherlands. Previous to working at the gallery, she was the creative director at Artem, an independent print magazine that celebrates works of art and artists from the northeast of India. Our last and youngest member of our team, Vasudha, is our research intern. She's majored in English literature at Ashoka University. She's extremely passionate about interdisciplinary work and hopes to do a master's in health humanities at the University of Edinburgh later this year. Her research till now has sought to understand dust in literature and how it might be connected to ideas of modernity and colonialism. Vasudha has done a lot of interesting research work as a part of this exhibition, including working with one of our exhibiting artists, Robert Good. Finally, before I start taking questions to the team, quickly to introduce myself, I'm Madhushree. I'm the program manager at Science Gallery. So I primarily work on developing exhibitions, programs, and whatever else we might do. I did my master's at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in neuroscience, where I was heavily involved in public engagement activities, and completed my second master's at NID, along with my other colleagues here, with a focus in information design. So as you can see, we're all from very different and very interesting backgrounds. And we hope today our conversation will also highlight how how our training in these specific areas has helped to shape Contagion to be the exhibition that it is. So I'd like to now start by asking our team to talk about their contribution and one of the things that they found most satisfying or challenging as a part of this exhibition. So, Gayatri, would you like to go?
Thank you, Madhu, for that introduction and for moderating this session. Welcome all. We're really excited to have you all here and share our process with you. So my colleagues later today will go over the various exhibits and programs that are a part of Contagion. Well, that's what we're all here for this evening. But what I want to highlight are some sections of the exhibition which might have missed your attention when you first explored it. And those are two sections titled Through Your Eyes and In Your Words. So a little bit of a background into what these programs are about, beginning with In Your Words. So In Your Words was a writing prompts program that we ran in the months leading up to Contagion. And the first run of this experiment was conducted in Phytopia. Incidentally, when I had just joined Science Gallery as their program associate, one of the first assignments I was given was to put together these creative writing prompts and send them out to our audiences and have our audiences respond to the prompts in either prose or poetry. And as someone who writes, who attempts to write in the speculative fiction genre, it was very interesting to see what kind of scenarios I could put together and share with our audiences. So we ran that during Phytopia and it was a big success. We had a sort of mentorship session with all the participants of the writing prompts program whose pieces were finally selected and shown as a part of Phytopia. And they expressed to us how it gave them confidence to write more and to submit their works to different magazines or galleries such as ours. So that was a very interesting experience, and we decided to build upon it in our exhibition season, Contagion. So along with my colleagues, Vasudha and Stuti, who used to work with us, we put together 12 writing prompts and shared them with our audiences. And they included everything from imagining if your dreams were interrupted by an advertisement, like if the whole world's dreams were interrupted by a single advertisement, and figuring out what that scenario could mean, or that you've managed to pull off the first global flash mob. What would that entail? And basically, these were very wacky, speculative sort of scenarios that we wanted our audiences to respond to. But they also explore the theme of transmission indirectly, which is what we endeavored to do with Contagion. So we received a lot of submissions, and of which we selected a few, and they are a part of our exhibition website in the section In Your Words. And we have everything from prose to poetry, and which is fitting because we don't want to discriminate between any form and would like to receive a breadth of submissions that span everything from creative fiction to nonfiction and poetry. So that was one really interesting part of putting this exhibition together, because it was not just what we were producing or we were curating or we were inviting speakers, but it was very interesting to listen to how our audiences would interpret these prompts. Following this, we also wanted to expand upon this idea of inviting submissions from our audiences, and we thought that it might be interesting to build on, invite different kinds of submissions in the form of different types of media. So we decided to run this program called the Photo Prompts Program. It was initially entitled, and we sort of decided to broaden the possibilities and invite these visual responses from the audience. So we were really thrilled to collaborate with the Chennai Photo Biennale's Learning Lab for this program. And in February, we put together 5 prompts: home, isolation, behind the mask, bubble, and viral. So these were really open prompts, and we wanted our audiences to interpret them in any which way they like and to share those responses with us. And it wasn't only restricted to photographs. We encouraged them to share with us GIFs, memes, animations. So the format here was not really critical. How creative and interesting the responses were was like how we sort of looked at the submissions. So we received some fabulous submissions, and I'd like to just share my screen so that I can take you guys through some of them. Yeah, so we received some fabulous responses, and in collaboration with the Chennai Photo Biennale, we shortlisted some of these responses, and we showcased them as a part of Contagion in the Through Your Eyes section. And as you can see, the submissions entail everything from street photography to portrait photography to, I don't know, even macro photography like this one. And we were really interested by these submissions. And we also had, in fact, a GIF that was submitted as a part of this program. So it really, I'm just scrolling to the GIF. Yeah, so this one was very interesting for us because it was about isolation. And she interpreted that, I mean, she is a photographer, the person who took this picture, I mean, who created this GIF. And she said that, because of the isolation that I'm feeling at home and my need to sort of relive experiences, I created this GIF of myself basically listening to a photograph. And what does listening to a photograph mean? What kind of emotions could that evoke? And that for us was a very interesting way to think about the prompt isolation, because we know that we are trying to live vicariously through past photographs, through, you know, our experiences of having had gone out to party back in the day. And for that reason, these submissions were really interesting to us. And we decided to have a mentorship session with the finalists along with the Chennai Photo Biennale team. So we invited all of them to come over to speak a little bit about what inspired them to respond in the way that they did, what the process behind creating that photograph was, what kind of state of mind they were in, because we have been, I mean, we all have our own ways of coping with the pandemic. So some of us might, you know, create things, others might consume, but that's completely all right. And we wanted to see, we wanted the session to be an interactive session where not only could they learn from their peers, but they could also be learning from industry professionals and the Chennai Photo Biennale team who have been involved in these activities for such a long time. So, and it was very interesting for us to see that some of the people who submitted their responses to the Photo Prompts program had previously submitted their responses to the Writing Prompts program during Phytopia. So they had evolved in the way that they were interpreting these prompts. They wanted to move away from writing and also, you know, explore other formats. So that was very interesting and creative and exciting for us. And going forward, I hope that we will also be able to experiment with different kinds of media so that we will be able, maybe we'll have prompts around music or zines or illustrations. And basically show everyone that you don't have to be a quote unquote artist or expert or scholar to create something meaningful that people can relate to, especially in this moment of shared vulnerability during the pandemic. So that was a really exciting process for us. And I know I'm taking up more time than intended, but I'll just wrap up very quickly. So I just want to say that, of course, this repository of photographs is very important because it also sort of archives the experience of living through the pandemic. And incidentally, we have another exhibit titled Controlling the Plague in British India by Christos Lynteris, which it's a historical sort of piece, and it has these photographs of containment measures taken by imperial authorities in order to control the third plague pandemic in British India. So that's, it's a very interesting juxtaposition if you move from one to the other. And I would invite you all to come and hear Christos Lynteris speak at our exhibition today at 6:30 p.m. So he's going to be speaking about plague and the emergence of photo epidemic photography. And those are my two bits. Thank you all for listening. And I'm excited to take your questions.
Thanks a lot, Gayatri. I think that was a very good plug for the 6:30 event. And I think the Through Your Eyes and In Your Words have been something that has been a success from Phytopia that we've, you know, really used well in Contagion also. I think, Komal, would you like to like go next and add in?
Thank you, Gayatri, for giving your bits on Through Your Eyes. I think for me also, I got to understand the process for the first time, having seeing the outcomes from the outside. So that was really interesting. So my contribution in the exhibition was the content management of various exhibits, programs, the social rooms, and the sections that Gayatri also spoke about. And the other part where I worked on was the design and development of the website, the exhibition website, nowtransmitting.com. So I would like to talk about two things regarding the website. Having been studied exhibition design and working in experiences that are in a physical space, working on this website was completely new. And one of the things that we had to figure out was how do you take the journey of a visitor or an audience into a digital space, where there's a story and there's an entrance to something, and you get your tidbits like of Easter eggs, and then you move on to see the whole picture. So that's what we try to explore with the website as well. And one of the key things to remember while doing this was, while we wanted to be experimental and new, we also had to make sure that the audience still has the familiarity of the websites the way they know of. So they are not in a completely alien territory. So that was really interesting to work on. And apart from what Gayatri mentioned, there were these as exhibits, programs in social rooms, and one of the key factors of contagion or any of the exhibitions that we do is all of these being interconnected. So this had to be reflected on the website as well. So how each exhibit leads to further programs, their web pages, and they further lead to the other take it further sections from say reading room or the listening room. And last bit about this particular thing was a key part of the curatorial vision is to was to have themes, and we had two categories of themes. One was the overall understanding of contagion, what it contains, and the other one was ways of knowing. So we worked around how can you plug this in the exhibition website, and this is where this particular part, how do you bring themes into the exhibition website? One of the major learnings was we were, this was again a first time experience working with developers and understanding tech-based constraints. So where do you meet your vision with the technology, and how do you, you know, build a bridge and be like, okay, so this is where we are going to, this is what's achievable, and this is something we need to look into our next exhibition. Maybe we try a different platform, or maybe we look at our theme engagement with the public a little differently. So this was a key factor, a really key learning to take away. And one of the challenging aspects, also one of my favorite aspects now that I'm looking back, was the plethora of content and understanding how do you segregate them, so that, because we were working in a team, we were working internally with Gayatri and Vasudha and then with the developers team. So how do you put forth content share content amongst each other where nothing gets lost, and you can like easily figure out what's missing, and you know, you don't waste time, because time was an important factor for us. And here's where the nomenclature, the way we create files, the way we set things up or communicate became a very important mode of communication. And we're really grateful that we did this for contagion, because we were discussing a week back as to how the nomenclature really helped us, and next time we're going to use it for like every single thing that we do. So yeah, that was fun.
Thanks, Komal. I think the reconciliation between the creative vision and what's possible functionality and what works for the audience is a really important point that all of us have to, I think, continue thinking about, right, as we go ahead for future exhibitions. Sankalp, would you like to tell us a bit about your experience now?
Am I audible? Yes. This is okay, right? Yeah. My experience has been great. That's one thing. But coming to the work that I've been doing at SGB is like designing a body of work, which again is the COVID's campaign videos. And those videos, basically they are five to six minutes, ranging from 3 to 6 minutes, let's just say, 3 to 6 minute videos, which every one video will focus or does focus on three major questions, which we get to ask to the audience, which are you guys, I mean the audience. And the questions are not really something that needs to be answered at the same point of time, but the questions need to be with you for a longer period of time for you or for the audience to basically reflect upon them. And the videos consist of speakers from various disciplines, and mostly scientists and people who are in different walks of life, basically. In some way or the other, science basically connects all of them together. So, and how do they actually talk to a regular general person about the anxiety about coronavirus or the various other aspects of coronavirus when we get to say a scientist when thinks him or herself. And the other thing is to get the general population or the general populace to understand various complicated concepts about science and technology, and to put it in a visual form so that it's much, much palatable and much more palatable to, you know, get their head around. I don't know if I make any sense or not, but that was the general way of moving forward with the body of work. And again, so I can have a discussion with COVID series, but then people have to watch the COVID videos first. So for that, I have to really say that please go ahead and watch those COVID videos. And there are 12 videos, short videos. And I think if you do a binge session of anything, we can do a binge session of COVID videos if we do a binge session of any other Netflix series or anything like that. So please go ahead and do that. And also, I'm kind of vaguely responsible for the YouTube section, or the videos and processing of the videos and the technical backend aspect of it. That's I guess about it. And that's it. Yeah.
Thanks, Ankur. Maybe before we go to the next person, you can tell us which was your favorite COVID, which you would advise people to start with, since there are 15.
Yeah, the favorite COVID will, see, if there are 15 videos, the favorite one will render 14 others kind of obsolete. So I don't know. But since I was working with COVID, so after one or the other video, I kind of, you know, started putting my head more into the videos. And till the end, I was really spending like 7, 8, 9 hours just to design, you know, subtitle transparencies, 5 hours for that. And so I think the 15th one, Mariam's video, is where I've put the most amount of effort in it. That doesn't mean you should watch it or not, but that's where I've put the most effort. And so please watch it. And also, like, watch every other video as well. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, I'll definitely second Sankalp on that. Mariam Ghani's video about the language and metaphors around that we use with the pandemic, a theme that recurs in several places across our exhibition. So I think Sankalp has done some brilliant work with all the videos. So definitely do catch it, as Sankalp has asked. And I think next we could go to Shweta. So Shweta, why don't you tell us a bit more?
Thanks, Madhu. So I was very lucky and excited to be on the creative side of building the exhibition. Got to do most of the fun work. Got a chance to design the visual language for the exhibitions. So the idea was to start with the main poster and sort of let it flow from there. So we explored a lot of colors and elements and graphics for what the main poster could look like. And after a lot of discussions with the team, we decided like the red really stood out, the color really stood out, and it communicated the elements of urgency and danger. So it was very relevant now. And yes, like then the idea of just having blue, so it just offsets the red, and it, like, we had a nice balance going on. And yes, we wanted the color palette to be very limited, to not exceed 4 colors, because also to kind of let that connection build with the viewer. And so they associate the colors with the exhibition. So that was a very important point. So the main poster became the starting point for everything that you see. So even the icons for the social rooms and the center graphic for the various programs, they were all derived from the main poster. So also then another point was to have it very graphical, because then we could construct and deconstruct the various elements of the main poster. So that was a very fun activity to do that. But it was fun, but it also was the most challenging bit, because then I had to design everything that would be within the color palette and in a similar style and still have it look fresh and new. So that was very challenging, but very fun. And yeah, I think from that, you know, from that idea, that the designing of the activity handbook was the most fun, because we also had very solid content and research behind it. So visualizing that was very fun to do. Yeah, that's about it.
Thanks, Shweta. I think it's becoming clear that the fun and challenging bits clearly go hand in hand for everyone. And I think the activity handbook is an excellent segue to go to Vasudha. So Vasudha, why don't you tell us a bit more about your experience with Contagion?
Yeah, thanks, Shweta. That is like Madhu said, a perfect segue. So I'll start by talking about the activity handbook then. So I was responsible for a lot of the research and the writing that went into this activity handbook. And you know, for those of you who might not know what this is, it's basically a short book with do-it-yourself experiments and activities interspersed with interesting, hopefully interesting things to read in between. And all of these are, you know, in some way or the other related to contagion, to the transmission of diseases, behaviors, and emotions that the exhibition explores. Yeah, and so the way I went about it, and again, both challenging and interesting, was to think about, what are the kind of activities that are doable for a person who might not have access to a lab setting or to a lot of, you know, tools or equipment that you might need for more sort of in-depth research and experiments. And also how to make it not just about diseases, because I think we've had these conversations across the team in many different ways, which is that, you know, contagion has now, particularly now, become very associated with disease. But we did also want to highlight the fact that, you know, there is contagion beyond and without disease as well. So I think I really also wanted to focus on what we could do, not just with diseases, but with behaviors and emotions, for example. And I think what was interesting to me is when I was brainstorming for ideas, I sort of went back to the things I've learned and, you know, done. So for example, a performing arts course that I'd done led to this playing the pandemic experiment of, you know, mirroring each other. And how that might relate to contagion. A conspiracy theory course I did led to this viral conspiracies experiment and so on. So that was really interesting for me to see, you know, the things that I already knew in some way, shape or form come alive in a completely different way. That was one thing. And yeah, another interesting thing that it allowed me to do was come across these random facts that I never would have otherwise. Like, for example, the first video that, you know, possibly went viral. And it's just like this person like breaking their computer, which, you know, I mean, a lot of us might relate to even today, given that, you know, what was the word you were talking about? Zoom.
Zoom fatigue.
Zoom fatigue. Yeah, yeah. Given that all of us are facing that these days. But yeah, anyway, so that was one part of it. And I will just share my screen, which I probably should have done earlier, but just to show you a little bit of it. And of course, Shweta has designed it and made it look, you know, much more interesting than I could possibly have. So that's amazing. And yeah, so this is the first activity called Playing the Pandemic, where, you know, not only did I look at performing arts, but then with my background in literature, I was also able to connect it to theater and pandemics, which was, again, quite interesting for me. Yeah, and I mean, I'm just flipping through this. If you want to watch this video, which is super viral, you should now, because it's going off of YouTube very soon, because it's been purchased as an NFT. yeah, so yeah, that is one thing, and I will stop sharing now. Another significant thing that you might have come across if you've seen basically any of our pages on the website is this Take It Further section, where you know, you find a plethora of articles to read, podcasts to listen to, and videos to watch. And I mean, I created I came up with a significant number of these links. And yeah, I mean, I think what was challenging in this was to think about the balance between what is relevant to the topic at hand, but what has not been covered already in the material that has come before it. So, I mean, how do you take it further while still maintaining the relevancy of the topic, but also, you know, finding hidden gems or, you know, untouched topics around the main theme. So that was something I was thinking of when I started sourcing these links. And I mean, one of my favorites of these is this, short article about an artist who used a wartime women's suit and patched it with silk that was died with E. coli. And this E. coli actually had was engineered with using CRISPR technology to remove its ampicillin antibiotic resistance. So she was basically trying to, you know, create awareness about antimicrobial resistance, which of course is a topic that we touch on in Contagion as well. And just the layers of interdisciplinarity and like different things that you have to think about and that can be thought of through that one piece of art were really interesting to me. So yeah, that's, yeah, you should go read it. I think the link is in the chat. So I would strongly encourage all of you to read it. Thanks.
And just to like add to what Vasudha said, that piece is by artist Anna Dimitriou, who actually exhibited in our first exhibition season Submerge with her work Archaeobot. So, you know, if you like that piece, definitely go check out Archaeobot in our Submerge archive as well. And Vasudha, last flex, how many take it further links are there on the entire website?
I think 500. Yeah, I was going to say like there are literally hundreds of things that you can, yeah, read and listen and watch. Yes. So
please
no exaggeration.
Please do go and explore all those links, and you know the exhibition website is going to be up for a while, so you know you can keep coming back in and checking them out and seeing new resources. The team keeps adding to them actually, so it doesn't stop, so you can always come in and find new resources at any point of time. Okay, and I think Janvi, who is also the co-curator and has generally been making sure that all this happens, Janvi, would you like to share with us your experience as well before we you know sort of get to some questions?
Yeah, so I think I'll speak only with the co-curator hat on. So I'm very sorry that Daniel Olson, who is my co-curator of the exhibition, is not able to join us today, because that would have been fun to be able to discuss with her in the room. That said, whatever we did it together, right? Like, so I think I'll speak about the curatorial experience, which is that like all our exhibitions, we had a curatorial team. And while the exhibition curatorial team was Daniel Olson, because, and one of the reasons why we reached out to Daniel is because she came to us with the experience of having run an international project called Contagious Cities, which closed just like, you know, just before the pandemic broke out, but also before, you know, we started thinking about contagion. So, I mean, the richness of our experience, you know, I mean, we contributed hugely. I mean, we couldn't have done contagion the way it stands today. I mean, all of us put in our effort, but she brought in a lot of sort of what we would call domain knowledge, which was very useful to think with, and also a network, right? A network of people. So do have a look at Contagious Cities when you have a moment, because that also that was in many ways the starting point for thinking about contagion. Of course, we took it elsewhere because, you know, Science Gallery, we do things, you know, in a particular way. And the other thing is that, so there's the curatorial team, and that curatorial team selects. And I think what I'd like all of us to also understand is that when we keep saying that, you know, that Science Gallery works, sort of, you know, Science Gallery doesn't, or in Science Gallery, our curatorial method is not of kind of following the vision of one or two people. What I'd like you all to understand is that apart from Daniel and myself, Madhu was also a part of the selection process, right? Like, so the exhibits and the programming as they sort of knit together is something that Daniel, Madhu and I have done together. So while she was in a sense primarily responsible for the program, and you know, Daniel and I were sort of primarily responsible for the curation and, you know, assembling things together, reaching out to people who we might want to invite, identifying things, Madhu's role was equally important to that process of bringing things together. And then what we benefited from, and again, this is something we follow for all our exhibitions, is the advice from our academic, is consultation with our academic advisors. And this time we had three. An old colleague of mine, well, he's not old, but you know, well, actually that's like saying I'm not old, but never mind. Sanjoy Bhattacharya, who's a historian of medicine. He brought in sort of the humanities and social sciences perspective on contagion. And we had Shahid Jamil, who's a virologist, who was our second academic advisor, and Mukund Taptai, who's a biologist, etc. You know, but just a generally sort of, you know, fabulous individual, but also a very strong academic who has earlier done art science work and exhibited at Science Gallery Dublin even before the Bangalore one came into existence. So we had these three people who we met with. We don't sort of bother them too much, but we have sort of very structured meetings with them also. So it took that many people in a advisory capacity for this thing to also come together. And then there were some, you know, there are some ideas that we follow, there are some methods that we follow, which have grown through our experience since the first exhibition. And of course, Madhu doesn't want me to say anything about the first exhibition at all, because literally the first exhibition team was Miss Madhu and Miss Janvi, and they had no idea. Neither of them had actually seen an exhibition from start to end happen, as in like under their own supervision or activity. But we did it, you know, we did it, it happened. Don't ask us how. So the ways in which we think, right, like, or the method, so to speak, is also something that has, and I'm hoping Madhu will say more to it, is something that has also emerged and been articulated now in hindsight. And I think Submerge was the first time we began to articulate, okay, what is it that we are doing? What do we prefer? What kind of exhibits do we want? What kind of programming do we want? What do we prioritize? And, you know, just this afternoon, actually, when Madhu and I were trying to articulate to a press reporter why we chose Blast Theory's cluster of 17 cases, I think sort of, you know, we were able to nail down together, you know, why we chose that. And that in a way, sort of, and when I was looking at it, I was like, huh, that's what we do, huh? And then, you know, you take that and you say, yeah, of course, we did that for pretty much every exhibit. But, you know, so it's also been a process of discovery. And what's actually quite delightful is also that two things, right? Like, we are able to, and this is true for, I mean, this has been true for Madhu and me, because Madhu and I have worked the longest together. Madhu was the first employee of Science Gallery Bengaluru. But also everyone who's come since, is that we're able to both agree and disagree at the same time, right? Like, I mean, objections in every meeting belong to Komal, you know, so they come in sort of at fairly regular intervals. No, I don't think it's to be done like that. But we find ourselves, once we articulate it, we find ourselves in agreement. So I think that collective thinking process of, you know, and oh, that's not quite, you know, I mean, I've always pushed very hard myself, as others, you know, my students before I came and joined Science Gallery Bengaluru, to, you know, accomplish something that I think is an ideal to accomplish. But I find actually that my team does that work even better than I do. I mean, they push me and they push each other hugely. I mean, so just to kind of end sort of this process of pushing each other in terms of articulating, I mean, there's what's very heartwarming for me, and I know Madhu still has to speak, is the humility of the entire team, actually. I mean, you know, pretty much every single person who has spoken until now has not put on the table, you know, pretty much everything they do. I mean, Komal has, for example, not mentioned the, you know, by content, she doesn't just mean content in English, but also in Kannada, and the kind of work it took to put that together, you know, when the rest of the team doesn't know, can neither read nor speak nor understand the language, what it means to actually put an entire exhibition website in an Indian language, which is also not happening otherwise, right? Like, I mean, it's not normal, right? Like, it's not that the entire, like in Germany or in the Netherlands or in Italy, bilinguality is a norm for cultural institutions. Here, it's not the case. And so how do you do it? How do you bring that the same degree of interactivity, and how do you bring the same degree of warmth, and, you know, how do you bring the same accuracy in the content? So I think that's where, you know, Komal has been huge. You know, Sankalp hasn't spoken about, you know, power outages where he lives, and what that has meant for actually making sure the videos are ready on time and are going up on time. I mean, you know, it's not, these are not trivial things. And also the hard work, again, pushback, right? No, I think this logo doesn't go here. This, you know, I mean, it's like, you have to put this here, right? Like, so complete pushback. And, you know, and of course he was right, you know, about that as well. Vasudha and her research abilities and her writing abilities, right? And the same for Gayatri. I mean, they Gayatri is the more sort of quiet worker, but again, the kind of creativity that, you know, and into the content that is brought in. Because it's one thing to have your exhibits and then, you know, sort of also have the programming in place, but the richness, you know, that comes in. And Shweta, right? Like, I mean, the poster that defined how the exhibition would look. And therefore, you know, it's, I mean, everything has to come together, right? Like everything simply has to come together. Otherwise, it's not an exhibition in a sense. It's a bunch of things together, right? Like, so that's the thing. I mean, and I think coming back to to research, and that's my final sentence, which is, I mean, 500 links, you know, I mean, Vasudha's done a huge amount of work. The rest of the team has contributed to it by what they find and, you know, just throwing things at her and hoping that she'll do something with it. Etc. But that is, to me, what, you know, for those of you who know the Spanish soup, the gazpacho, which is like a cold soup, you never see the bread in it, but it's the bread that's been put in that holds everything together, right? Like it gives it the texture. And I think the research for this exhibition, which we are very happy to share with our audiences, is what keeps it together. It's really, I think, the intellectual glue of the entire thing. It's like, it allows you to make sense of the exhibits and the programming because you can, at your own pace, try to find why it's there, you know, and therefore then also find a way into, you know, the team's heads in a sense, right? Like, why did they put it together this way? And making that process accessible has been important to us because what we are trying to push is boundaries of public engagement. And hopefully we'll continue to do that. So that's the curatorial, sort of broadly speaking, the process.
Thank you, Janvi. The curatorial process also includes a lot of tea and other,
yes.
other energy
yes.
add-ons.
Regular tea breaks.
Yes. So since we are kind of nearing the end of the session and we have, I'd like to encourage everyone to put their questions in. I can quickly just add my two bits while people are adding their questions and the team members can read the questions in that time while I'm chatting. And
yes.
decide which ones you'd like to, you know, answer. So I'd encourage people to add their questions while I share what was my favorite bit of the exhibition, because if I don't, I'm sure I'll get scolded afterwards. So I think my favorite bit of the exhibition, my contribution is, I think, very like kind of spread out everywhere. I don't think I can say this one particular thing, but I think my favorite bit.
Well, I think shaping the mediator program is something that yeah. I mean, while you have, of course, done everything, but you know, as in like you have fingers in every pie, but I think the mediator program is really something you have shaped. So I think you should kind of take credit
yeah.
for that. Of course, you can speak about whatever you want.
I can. So definitely, I think mediator program is something that I enjoy. And, you know, I think with Vasudha this time, we've managed to have a month-long mediator training session where we've had 32 young people from all across India joining in for sessions with artists, scholars, and learning a lot, including us, and being prepared to, you know, take on the public and their questions. So I think I think engaging with them is definitely a highlight of the exhibition. I think for all of us in general, when we interact with the mediators, but so I definitely, you know, ask everyone to come in for a session with them to, you know, because that is the absolute best way to see the exhibition. But I think also my personal favorite is probably usually writing the first draft of the open call, because that happens when the exhibition is still far away, and it's a very calm moment when, you know, you're thinking about the theme, you're thinking about the name, and you write this open call without any idea of what will come in. But I think in a sense, it always is the moment of greatest clarity, because it's when you really are very free to think about what the exhibition could be in all its sort of scope. And I always write a bad draft and Janvi edits it. But I think that's one of my, like, it's always a moment that stays with me, because in a sense, it sets up so many things. The words we use in there are so important. The way we frame it is so important to what comes in. And I think especially in this exhibition, choosing to show contagion beyond disease was a key decision that we made at that time, especially given that was the moment when the first lockdown started and, you know, there were conflicting opinions whether it would be a good idea to have an exhibition on this topic at all. So I think that was a interesting challenge and a thing that we thought about. But yeah, and I think the other thing, of course, is the conversations. We have several lead-up conversations with speakers, with artists, with facilitators, And some of these happen at 12 p.m. at night. Some of these happen during normal working hours. But I think I have learned so much just from sitting in on these conversations with advisors, with speakers and experts. And I think many of them are like, you know, we had Heidi Larson taking interviews on the other end, but still giving us 10 minutes of her time to do like a COVID video. So I think the privilege of being able to hear them speak freely, share insights on what is happening in today's world was, I think, also just a big part of what I enjoy about bringing an exhibition together. So, yeah, I think that's pretty much it from my end. I think we can.
Can I say that you are? Yeah, can I say that Madhu is really good at coming up with titles? So COVID was like her title. I mean, so you know, we discussed the idea. Then Daniel and I, you know, we were talking about three messages, and then Daniel said actually three questions. And you were like, okay, done. This is fabulous, right? Like, and then Madhu's like, yeah, COVID. That's what we'll call it. Or when we did Elements, for example, she came up with Stuff That Matters, right? Like, and so she's very good at coming up with titles. Gayatri is incredible at identifying the right film. So during Phytopia, I mean, Phytopia was when it started, but even after. So Gayatri has this sort of, Gayatri is a repository of, you know, films. Vasudha, of course, you know, she's sort of, you let her loose on the net and with books, and, you know, she comes back with fabulous things. Komal is sort of, you know, Komal trans, so her eye for detail is incredible, and it's like it goes from design to content both, right? And that's unusual in many ways, because she's able to look at the technical aspects of the design with the same degree of sort of thoroughness as she's able to look at the content. So, you know, collectively it kind of all sort of comes together, and you know, there are people who are very good at very specific things, and then they do everything else as well.
Shall we take some questions? There are a couple of questions here. I think one we can address right off the bat is, how big is the curatorial and design team who worked on this exhibition?
You see them all.
Yes,
this is it. Apart from Daniel, yeah.
We do have developers as well, because we don't have the in-house IT skills. Going forward, we hope to have our in-house development team, for future exhibitions. But yes, at the moment, this is sort of the team you see in front of you. Our communications associate, Vishaka, is also here. She's behind the scenes, but equally important part of making sure that our exhibition is visible to all of you. Yeah, I think that's a very important thing. What was the demographic of the people who responded to the prompts, other than the age, which was defined? Gayatri, maybe you want to take that?
It wasn't very specific. So we had submissions from people from various backgrounds and different genders and nationalities. So really the age was the only restriction and the only category that, you had to match the eligibility criteria to participate. But it was very diverse, actually, I would say.
Shweta has a question, and I know Shweta has been there for a bunch of our tutorial sessions and some workshops as well. She says that it's been great listening to all the nitty-gritties of our work, made her better appreciate the exhibition. Thank you. I was wondering how you all communicate with each other, given that each one of you work on different aspects of the project. How does it all come together for you? Who wants to take this one?
Yeah, because you've been trying to get us to move to like online communication for a while.
I think it is difficult, especially because several of the team members have actually never met each other in person. Many of us are in different cities. And of course, like you yourself said, we work on different aspects of the project. But an advantage of having a small team is that none of us are, again, constrained to one particular part of the, you know, role. Like Gayatri said, three people worked on the writing prompts. As Komal said, everyone is involved in getting the content together. I think it's regular meetings. That's where all the Zoom fatigue comes from. We start at 9:30 in the morning, and there's a meeting, and then there's another meeting. But I think communication is very key, whether it's, you know, through calls or, you know, we also write wonderful emails and lots of WhatsApp messages to each other as much as possible. So I think that that is it. And I think we also enjoy getting feedback from each other, whether it's on a graphic for a poster, whether it's on a video or the, you know, the visuals that Sankalp is adding, or, you know, it's where a button is going on the website. I think everyone has always takes the time out to share their feedback and their thoughts on this. So no team member is really in anything alone. There's always, you know, the rest of their colleagues to back them up, support them, and sometimes tell them there's a typo. So yeah, that's
it. I think Komal wants to say something.
Yes, Komal, go.
Yeah, so we use, as Madhu said, regular meetings, emails, and WhatsApp, and we've been trying to move to an efficient platform. So if you have any suggestions as to what works, you could let us know in the Q&A box.
Yeah. I don't see any other questions. So Nana says hi.
Hi, Sunaina.
Is there any, if there are no other questions, maybe we can just close, because we have a talk coming up in, you know, 20 minutes or so. But maybe, Janvi, you could end with saying a bit, a line or two about the next offering that's coming up with Science Gallery. So for those looking forward to that.
Sure. So before I tell you about the next topic, I'd like to share a joke, and that exactly. I have a very bad sense of humor, according to my team. But this harks back to, you know, somebody goes and asks Gandalf, how is it that you don't know about something or the other? Aren't you like in charge here? And I think that is a question that could be asked of me also. And he says, Gandalf's answer is, are you kidding me? I'm just the boss. So I think that's pretty much how this team works. Everyone takes responsibility and takes charge of what they do. And I think that's why we are able to move ahead and do what we're able to do. So our next offering, which was my mandated task, if I don't fulfill it, I'm going to get it badly in the morning meeting. So I should do that. We closed our open call for the next exhibition season, which is called Psyche. And that will open later, like either much later this year, so like towards the end, or early next year. So hopefully we'll start working on that once we've kind of put the bulk of intensive programming around Contagion behind us. We also, given the relevance of Contagion and the resources that we've been able to put together, we are also thinking of extending the timeline for Contagion to the end of the year, although we won't be programming as intensively. We'll probably program, and I'll leave that to Madhu and her team to decide how and what, because those things are still under discussion. But what we are sure about is that we will leave the exhibition live until the end of the year. So there will be opportunities to come back. Some of it will be gone after June 13th, so don't count on everything being there. But yes, the next offering, so to speak, will be Psyche. And we are also thinking of doing something around deep history, deep history of time, Anthropocene, geological definitions of geological ages, etc. That will be what we will have to offer towards the end of next year. So like end of 2022. So that's what we are working on. So if any of you are interested, or if you have people who are interested in any of these topics, stay in touch through the open call process, or if you need any further information, or if you have ideas that you wish to share, write to us at either, whatever that address is, you can put it in the chat box, guys. The relevant address, because I don't know which one. So those are the two offerings, and we will, once we've had a little bit of breathing time after this one, we'll be starting to work on those two. So looking forward to have many of you and your friends come and join us for those as well.
Yes, absolutely. And as Janvi said, hopefully by the time we are at Anthropocene, the building will be up, and we will be able to meet all of you in person, more like you will be able to meet us in person, and we'll have a live meet the team again. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today evening. We're really grateful that you could make it and, share in our experiences. If you have more questions about making digital exhibitions or want to share your thoughts on the exhibition, do, share it with us in a feedback form or, send us a mail at info@bengaluru.sciencegallery.com. We are fairly prompt in responding to all emails and, we'd love to discuss things with you. So please do continue to stay home, stay safe. And if you are able to, do join us for the lecture with Christos on the other side in another Zoom link. Okay. Have a good evening, everyone. Take care. Bye-bye.